Hello and welcome to the program Out in Front. It is a sunny day out here in Corona, in the outskirts of Los Angeles, California, in the United States of America. I am loving the weather, but most of all, I am loving the idea that this beautiful sun and this instrument right here might be the solution to Cameroon's energy crisis. That is what my guest and I will be talking about and much more. And if you want to know who he is, I will tell you that his ingenuity stemmed from the lack of a basic commodity. Barely at the age of 12, still in primary school, he made his first invention, an apparatus that lit his parents' home. 47 years after, his passion for invention has got better, and today he might be the solution to Cameroon's energy crisis. Caspar Martin Wadinga is an electromechanical engineer and a board-certified senior industrial technologist. A former student of St. Joseph College, Sasebo, and a graduate of the California State University with a Master's of Science degree in Reliability Engineering and specialty in electromechanicals. He is a business entrepreneur, founder, president, and CEO of VSI Technologies Incorporated, based in Los Angeles in the United States of America. Now, Martin Caspar Madinga hails from Balinyonga in the Northwest region of Cameroon. He is married to Lisi Tata Caspar, and together they have two beautiful kids. Welcome to the program, Martin.
Thank you very much.
You are an innate genius. At barely 12, you made your first invention. You want to tell me about this?
Well, like they say, every invention is based on necessity. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what, you know, drove me to do what I did. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I didn't know what I was doing. I was just doing it because I wanted to fulfill a need. Mm-hmm. Yeah, today, we still use the same concept by saying, you know, you design based on the requirements mm-hmm. or a problem to solve. Mm-hmm. So I solved the problem by creating light because we had a lighting issue at home. I did not want to use the local lamps. I wanted to get something that I can look and have a better illumination.
Okay. Immediately after high school, you arrived America, basically September 1982. And in your own words, you said you landed here like a bird, where you got your name, Mungo Park. You want to tell me about this story?
I mean, it is simple to understand how a bird navigates its environment, mm-hmm. right? If the bird flies, he had never been there. He's just been released by the parent to go. Just go. And that's exactly what happened to me. I took off. I knew nobody in the United States, Los Angeles, California in general. I didn't know anybody. And then coming here, I arrived without knowing anybody. So I had to navigate. And that's exactly why they call me Mungo Park, because I was just coming here to figure it out.
You graduated from the California State University with a Master of Science degree in Reliability Engineering and specialty in Electromechanicals.
Yeah.
You want to tell me a little bit about your training and how you got into the corporate world?
To graduate with a degree in Reliability Engineering, you must first of all have a Bachelor of Science degree in any technical field. That was the requirement then. So it can be any engineering, science field, anything that is, you know, technical or science based. Then you are qualified to get into reliability engineering. And then based on your background training, that's where you're going to use in reliability training. So you focus more on what you know best and then move on from there and be able to get what is required for every reliability engineer. Now, when you are in the course, there is a lot of probability studies. There's a lot of statistics. Of course, math is a given. Statistics for engineers is not just regular statistics for engineers. And then design of experiments is part of your life, both factorial and any kind of design experiment that you can think of. So the whole scenario is based on probability. So probability is the talk of the profession. Probability and statistics, it comes out of your ears. So be ready. If you're going to go into that field, be ready to play statistics to the max, probability to the max. Anything that will come up with something requires, you know, permutations. So design of experiments to come up with something that actually works.
Tell me about getting into the corporate world in America.
Getting into corporate world, based on that kind of training, the corporate world needs people like that. You cannot go wrong with that. I mean, I never experienced layoff. I never experienced that because of the kind of training that I had. Every time you move from one project to other, you definitely need a reliability engineer for anything that has to be made. If you're going to make something, it has to be reliable. So if you're going to be a reliability engineer, you're going to be needed at all times.
Yeah. That's so how is your own experience getting into the corporate world in America?
Okay, my experience there for the past 30 years, I would say, you know, has been a very challenging one. You know, I wouldn't say it was all milk and honey. It was hard work. Hard work, meaning I barely had sleep. I traveled the world because we had products all over the place, right? We had, you know, test labs all over the place. So I had that experience while I was in that field, and I enjoyed it. There was a lot of stress there, and I had series of awards, President's Awards, CEO Awards, the highest achiever awards. But if you look at it very well, there's none that comes there sleeping on the job.
Prior to becoming a business entrepreneur, you spent 10 years in aerospace industry and over 20 years in Zerographic. You want to tell me about this particular phase in your life?
That was some kind of transitional, you know, way to arrive to the finish line. But aerospace, when I got out of school, because the course was sponsored by aerospace companies, so I went into aerospace. I liked it. It was a little bit stressful, or very stressful, more than the commercial world, because it had defense intelligence and other stuff all mixed in there, so you cannot play around. Something to fail is not an option.
Aerospace, first of all, what is it?
This is the ability to put airplanes in the air, you know, from defense side or commercial. You do all those stuff just to retain the airplane. Mm-hmm. I won't go into much details about warheads, but that's what it is. So going into that field strengthened me in that reliability engineering background, because now I know what it means to have something designed and it fails. Yeah. So with that kind of mentality, I took it and dived with it into commercial, because I had to go back to Cameroon.
All right. Remember, tell me about Zerographic.
Zerographic falls in the commercial world more, right? Because consumer products at low levels, that's what they do.
You call it simply putting ink on paper.
Yeah, putting ink on paper. That's the basic function of Zerographic, putting ink on paper. So the equipment that we come up with to put ink on paper, laser printers, photocopy machines, and all that, Xerox did it well. Like, the name Zerographic came from Xerox.
What made you astounding during your over 30 years in the corporate world? What did you do concretely that made you stand out?
What I did specifically that was really my motto, and even most of the directors, the CEOs, they knew about me, was benchmarker. Benchmarker, which means you make something that's going to be used to reproduce other stuff. So in other words, that stuff is not there or wasn't made, the rest of the peripheral stuff would never happen. So benchmarker was my key strength. Mm-hmm.
You had a brilliant career. You did you delivered excellence. You had a lot of awards. And just like that, you decided to bridge into retirement, a risk, I should say. Why will you take such a big risk? You had a good job. You had a steady job, steady income. Why will you risk all that to start your own business?
I did the calc, did the calculation based on age, based on where I'm going to be at finish line, based on or what I have already pre-existing. I said, no, if I don't live while I'm still strong, I live while I'm in a diaper, I will not meet that finish line. So I said, you know, because I'm leaving Xerox as an inductee. I'm not leaving Xerox as somebody who just came look for a job and got out or got a job. I did stuff that is there is traceable and everything, but unfortunately, I have to think the way I was thinking when I was coming here. Come here, get it, bring it back. So I overstayed the course. Yes, I did. For some reason, I did. Now, to close the loop effectively is to go when you're still strong enough to deliver.
Now, you're talking about deliver. You actually delivered by coming up with two products, the Solarmatic and the Power Anywhere. You want to tell me about these two inventions?
Yes. Okay, Solarmatic was my baby. This is where I'm talking about Benchmarker. Now, the Benchmark product that I came up with is the Solarmatic. Then the peripheral products that came out of Solarmatic is the Power Anywhere, because you get power anywhere when you have the Solarmatic intelligence in it. Right here we have G-Flex, it's one of them. Over here we have Power Anywhere on wheels. So when you look at this whole concept of Solarmatic, you will understand exactly what I mean by being a benchmarker. And Solarmatic basically is an electromechanical device that works with the sun automatically. All it does is opens your windows at sunrise, and during the day, the angles of the louvers will alternate depending on the sun's intensity. And at nighttime, the louvers will all go back to home position, meaning it closed. You don't have to touch it, just install it and walk away. When all this happens, it controls the sun's rays getting into your house or office. So there are a lot of effects on sun's rays getting into your office. The glare on your computer screen, you will never have it when you have Solarmatic on, because it will do it for you before you even know it, because you know the intensity of the sun right now, these rays can be strong.
So Solarmatic is more about using solar energy to take care of, you know, opening and closing of blinds.
Basically, that's what it is. So it does that automatically without anybody touching it. So it uses the sun's intensity to control the functions of the louvers to create the scene that you're going to have in the house as far as temperature control. Temperature is very critical. So when you do that automatically, you don't have to get up. Say you're a sick person in the bed. Do you have to get up and open your window to see light? No. So it might have opened the window for you. The advantages are numerous. You have invasion of privacy or people intruding into your homes. Mm-hmm. But Solarmatic will automatically be functioning whether you're there or not. So it will simulate motion in the house, and people will not be able to come there because they figure out that somebody must be there opening and closing the windows from all parts of the house. Mm-hmm. Not only that, the sun's intensity that goes into the house, that's what keeps your AC out of full efficiency, because this sun is there, it's transferring heat, and your cooling effect is dropping. So you become like someone who doesn't have AC because you didn't have the right window treatment. Mm-hmm. Okay? And then you have also safety in the house. If you have Solarmatic in your house in a hard to reach window, most cathedral ceiling windows, they are really hard to reach. But they are good designs, they make the house highly illuminated in the daytime, you don't have to use electricity. But the safety of operating it and cost effectively is not there.
Okay.
Solarmatic will give you all that.
Okay, now tell me a little bit about the Power Anywhere.
Okay, Power Anywhere, like the name says, you can get power anywhere you want to be at. Because if you need power and you don't have the power, you cannot do what you need to do with the power. So here, this is a Power Anywhere device. It has two functions here, actually three functions. It has a solar panel that makes or give him the capability of generating, you know, electricity, makes electricity from the panel, and it gets harnessed down into a storage bank, and the storage bank keeps it there until nighttime. When nighttime comes, using Solarmatic technology, it emits the light from the LED, and the LED, you know, brightens the whole area. So illumination around the area now becomes evident, which was not there before. And then not only that, there is power that you need for your cell phone, and if you don't go to any outlet to get power, you will not be able to use your phone. So I'm saying you have power anywhere when you have this device. This box is power on wheels. As you can see right there, it's on wheels. You can roll it to anywhere and get power to electrify your home with basic illumination and cell phone charging. Anywhere, anytime. It generates power. So that's why I say we don't distribute power in this industry. We generate, we make our own.
Okay.
So there it is. You make your own power with a solar panel, you know, and then you store it there in the storage bank. And then at night you use it, How you want to use it?
All right. You took this initiative to Cameroon in 1992, and between 1992 to 2011, you went to Cameroon back and forth trying to make people understand this new concept of solar energy. But it wasn't digested, I should say. Thank God in 2014, you started the first phase of your business, which is VSI Technologies. You want to tell me about this business, what it involves?
Okay, Vertical Systems Integrated Technologies. If you break the acronym VSI, V for vertical means growth. Mm-hmm. Okay, systems. It's a combination of more than one system.
Yeah.
Integration is putting together those systems to make a system that is going to be better than what the initial component of that system was. So now, at that point, you are experiencing growth vertically.
All right. Now, tell me a little bit about what makes this particular concept or this particular project different. You're talking a lot about solar energy. We've had a series of them in Cameroon and they failed us. What makes yours different? What makes it reliable?
Okay, this is very interesting because I'm going to go straight to the point. I have made it a challenge to succeed where people fail. So where people fail was engineering in the old school. People don't fail when they have reliability training because you design every product to function and last. That's what really constitutes reliability. So when I take my product out there in the field, I'm standing behind the product 100%. So if I can stand behind the product 100%, the product is going to work. If it doesn't work, it means it didn't meet its intent. If it's abused, that's something else.
Who are your clients? Who are those who are supposed to use your products?
My product is the most common and most desirable product you can ever think of. Light, power. You can't go without any of them. Now, as far as the threshold of the people that I'm targeting, 70% of them have deficiency in illumination, basic illumination. I'm not talking about appliances, basic illumination, mm-hmm. 70%. So if I put it in a trend where I have to solve the problems, I say 70% of the people, I go there first and solve that problem there first. The product sells itself. The clients are unlimited. It all depends on what you want to apply the product to. But my principal target clients are the low-end consumers, which constitutes of 70%. 70% of the people in Cameroon have problems with light, which is the basic requirement. Mm-hmm. 70%, which includes the family, the kids and everybody. Okay. The kids especially who need to study. They cannot read without light.
So those are your clients. But you can also work with big companies.
Yes, I can work with big companies, but it's going to be mostly on custom meaning it has to be specific on the usage, what they're going to do, what equipment they're using, and what's, the runtime of the equipment that they're using.
Tell me a little bit about cost. You said the basic customer is you and I, but mm-hmm. how about cost?
Yeah, the cost, it's really tailored to what you need, right? Because I have here the basic requirement that any home in Cameroon will have is a 10-watt system. For illumination, mm-hmm. 10 watt system. And 10 watt system, probably about maybe $1,400, mm-hmm. right? You can power 10 rooms all night if you want.
And you say you can never go wrong because it is very sustainable.
Yes, it is very sustainable. If you have a solar panel that gives you warranty for 25 years, how long are you going to be complaining after the 24th year that, my solar panel failed?
So reliability is 25 years.
25 years. The LED bulb is the most efficient at this moment. It's guaranteed for 10 years.
Okay.
So you only change your light bulb if you didn't abuse it after 10 years. Check about what you spent in 10 years if you didn't have power anywhere. That's how you figure out the cost.
We all understand the energy crisis that Cameroon is facing, and You have a vision. You think you have a solution to that.
This solution is all in Power Anywhere. Because when the people sat down, I'm talking about the engineers, mm-hmm. sat down and sized Cameroon, you know, to supply power, right? They used a requirement at that point, which is variable. It's not static. It goes all over the place because once people start growing in their profession, they make money, they're going to go out there and go buy equipment that requires power. But the power company is not constantly evaluating power consumption like that. They carve out an area, they keep a transformer, they distribute power to that place. Mm-hmm. When that area now is flooded with, you know, high demand, they're not going to go.
Exactly.
Yeah, they're not going to do it. So
you are everywhere.
I am everywhere anytime because I generate, I do not distribute power.
Tell me some of the challenges that you're facing in business right now.
Oh, the challenge right now is education. The consumer population, they are not properly exposed. The reason behind product cost. So those are the challenges that I'm facing. And then the most important thing is the bias factor of the existing, you know, suppliers in the market, especially in the developing world. The Chinese market went in there and flooded the place, tinting them exactly on how product reliability is defined. So they buy a lot, it doesn't work, they go buy another one. But that's not the way we were trained. You make something that works and it has to stay working.
One thing we should also know about you is the fact that you are a family man. You have a beautiful wife and two children. And you say that while you are busy energizing the houses and the lives of many other people, she is energizing your life.
Exactly. Because over the course of time, before you get to the finish line, like I said, you're going to experience ins and outs, ups and downs, and you need to stay calm to get to the finish line, because if you didn't get there, you don't get there, you cannot bring back anything home. So I found this woman at the right time when I was approaching the finish line. So running out of gas, she came in there and added that gas. And I kept on and I hit the finish line way ahead of time, because to do research and development to come up with products, very stressful. The corporate job that I was in was very stressful. I was never home. So to have a strong woman who can take care of the rest of what you're supposed to do,
we're getting emotional here. Now, what's the little name you have for her? I understand that she's called Lisi Tata. Yeah.
Yes.
Kaspar. But you have a little name for her?
I have a name for her. This name came up right when I met her over the phone. Mom.
I like
that. That's her name. Okay. Her name has been Mom since for the past 20 years.
You also have an...
She didn't have a kid then, though.
I understand that you also have a secret lover, a girlfriend, that your wife kind of condones or accepts her presence. That is your bass guitar.
Yes. Yep. She's okay to a certain extent. But at some point when she gets really too much of it, you say it's loud. Because the bass guitar is something, if you don't understand music, you can't really enjoy it. Because the rhythms are loud, it's supposed to be loud. Mm-hmm. Because they control. So once I start playing and get to that amplitude, she is not a happy camper.
To the end of the first phase of the program, and I'm taking you to the second phase of the program, which is tic-tac. Kaspar, your strength.
My strength is basically on my family.
Your weakness
stems from arrogance.
One thing America has taken from you and one thing America has given you.
The only thing America has taken out of me is the bonding with my people. What America has given me is the ability to siphon the knowledge that I had here and take it back home.
What animal would you have loved to be if you were not human?
I say a dog, because the dog is the best friend for a man.
What do you miss most back home?
I think I miss the warmth of family, of Cameroon.
Food on your mind?
Definitely ndole.
Back home friends that you want to say hello to?
Oh, numerous. First of all, I need to say hello to one of my I say, most instrumental friend for me to come back, Prince Eyango, who actually inspired me, actually singing a record for me, Home Be Home. If you can listen to that record, you will understand. It's very emotional, but that motivated me to actually find out how can I go back.
Do you speak Mungaka? You are from Balinyonga?
Bani munchati, you know, yomu mwanyonga ninshumbo bendindi. Bijun yoke mbi bana baba malangju. Bobo agere yoke, machini njem, kuba akubongba, mayon vi ndi imu bani chumu ninje yombo mkea. Uba ajun yonyum, nchi mbona, bonma diaspora. Bekinju yonyumu nchundi ndia, bibanju your product ma kumvi, bijun mbi bana bobo aget. Gong di me bon bo adoti ngwani ni electricity kuboni true kangba
music on your mind
to say que dans la vie tout le monde n'est pas comme ça tout le monde n'est pas
millionnaire
tout le monde n'est pas millionnaire il faut pas compliquer la vie.
And it's on that positive note that we come to the end of today's edition of the program. Hope to see you next time.